Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Okay, we will continue from what we left yesterday. What was the last scripture we were learning? No, what I was teaching. Yeah. Mark chapter 11, verse 23. For verily, I say unto you that whosoever shall pray, okay, shall say unto this mountain,
be removed,
and be thou
cast into the sea.
And cast into the sea,
and shall not doubt, in his heart, but
shall believe
that those things, which he says, which he says,
shall come to pass.
He shall have.
Stop. What he shall say shall come to. What he shall say shall come to. You are reading something different? What he says will come to pass. What do we say? Some translation says, what I say will happen. What do we say? Are we saying the things that is happening? Yes. Yes? If doctor gives a bad report, what is the first thing you do? The moment you get that report, you speak what you have. Yes? If you have a problem in your office or in your college or in your house, what is happening is what you say. What I see is what I say. Yes? What is happening is what I speak. But what is the Bible saying? What you say is what you have. If you want to change what you have, then you have to change what you say. It's a law. Yesterday we were studying, it's a law. What is a law? What you say is what you have is a law. If you are, you know, the problem is not with your praying. Many of your prayers are dangerous because many of your prayers are, you keep saying your problem. And you might be thinking, I'm praying, but nothing is happening because what you're saying is happening. Prayer will not make faith to work. Prayer will not make faith to work, but faith will make your prayers to work. Can you write that? Prayer will not make your faith to work, but your faith will make your prayer to work. The problem is when we pray, there is no faith in our prayer. Our prayers are filled with fear. Yes? That's why our prayers are not working. Because there is no faith in our prayers. Prayer will not make faith to work. But faith will make But faith will make. You got confused? Prayer will not make faith to work. Yeah, faith to work. But why you wrote God there? But okay, because I'm seeing you became conscious. Okay, but faith will make your prayer to work. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Our prayers are not working because we are saying what we are saying. We are speaking about our problem. We are speaking about our situation. We are speaking about the negative things that is happening in our lives. That is the reason when you keep saying what is happening, then what is there will not change. That's why yesterday we saw my people are destroyed because of lack of prayer. Some of them are awake. My people are destroyed not because of lack of prayer, but my people are destroyed because of lack of knowledge. If you don't have knowledge of how, yesterday we saw that every scripture is a law. What is a law? A law, what is a law? Let me see now. I think every session I should have a question. What is the law? Law is a principle. Whoever involves in the law, the result will be the same. A law is a principle. Whoever involves in it, the result will be the same. I gave an example. If I put the pen, it goes up. When you put the pen, it goes down. Yeah? Can we see? I put something, it will go up. You put something, it will go down. No. It is universal. Whoever involves in the law of gravity, the result is the same. In the same way, this book, the Bible, is a book of law. Yesterday we saw God told to Joshua, do not depart this book of the law. This book is the book of law. And anyone who applies this law, the result will be the same. That's what we see in the verse 20, same, 23. For verily I say unto you that whosoever, is it given? Or it's given only the preacher, only the Catholic, only the CSI, it's given like that? Or it's given whosoever? Because the book of the law, the Bible, the scriptures in the Bible is a law which is universal. It's a principle that anyone who involves in it, the result is the same. Whoever you might be, it's clear. It's very clear. Whoever you are, it's a law. If you speak to this mountain, the mountain shall obey. But the problem is, instead of speaking to the mountain, we speak about the mountain. Instead of talking to the problem, we speak about the problem. It's a law. Whoever you are, if you are going to speak about your problem, your prayers will not work. If you are going to, from morning till night, if you are only going to speak what you see, then your prayers will not work because you are violating God's law. That's why God is saying, my people are destroyed because of lack of knowledge. You have not understood how this principle works. God created everything on laws. Everything is created based on physical laws and spiritual laws. And when I understand how these laws work, these principles work, and apply them, whoever I am, the result will be the same. Are you understanding? Praise the Lord. For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he said shall come, that those things that he says shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he says. He shall have whatsoever he says. He shall have whatsoever he says. Say this, I shall have whatsoever I say. I shall have whatsoever I say. I shall have whatsoever I say. So be careful what you're saying. Yes? So be careful. The problem is, what you have you don't want, and you say and you have that only. What you have is what you're saying, and what you're saying is what you're having. You're having so much problems, and all the times you're saying the problems, that's why the problems keep multiplying. And you might ask God, why Lord did you allow all this? And the Lord is answering you, I did not allow. What you say is what you have. Because somebody is jumping from the fifth floor, will God stop the law of gravity? No. In the same way, these laws are given for your good. But if you are violating, God will not change his laws. I have to change my words. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Okay. Go to Genesis. Romans chapter 4. We'll come back afterwards to Genesis. Romans chapter 4, verse 17. Okay. As it is written, I will make you a father of many nations. Did I read it rightly? You can see? Am I? As it is written, I will make you. Okay, go to the 19th verse. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead, when he was about 100 years old. When did God say this? When he was almost 100 years old, and he did not have any children. And God is saying that I will make you. I am seeing anybody is sleeping or not. God is saying, I have made you. That means God is not a God who will speak what he sees, but God is a God, he will speak what he wants. Because God created us in his own likeness and image. God will first say, and what he says, he will have it. Are you getting it? And God created us in his likeness and in his image. That's why we have to first say, and then only we will have it. That's why he first said, go to the 17th verse. God first said, I have made you. And it is written, I have made you a father of many nations. Can you give RSV translation, NRSV? Yeah. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations in the presence of God in whom he believed. Okay. Was Abraham 100 years old? Did God promise that I have made you the father of many nations? Is it possible logically for a person to become a father of many nations, 100 years old? But how did Abraham believe? The answer is there in that. How he believed? No, I read it. What is there I read just now? Shall I give the answer? Shall I give the answer? In the presence of God, he believed. Okay, yesterday I asked you a question. I'll ask again, let me see. At least now you give me answer. Did the Israel people saw the Red Sea departing? Did they saw water coming from the rock? Did they saw the pillar of God with them day and night? Did they see great miracles, manna falling from the heaven? If you would be in such condition, what would be your faith? It's very strong. Yes? Yeah? Yeah? I can forgive anybody but not you. You're sitting in the first row and saying yes? Sorry, I forgive you. See, faith will not increase by seeing something that is physical. You forgot? How will faith come? Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. You can never violate any law in the Bible. Everything works on this principle. How the law works. Take Romans 10:17. We'll come back here. So faith comes from what is heard, and what is heard. Give the other translation. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. How faith comes? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. There is no other way that I will get faith. The only way that faith comes is by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Faith, the Bible doesn't say faith will come by seeing miracles. That miracle which you see is just an attraction for you to the word. And when you get into the word, now it is that word that gives you faith. And without this faith, none of our prayers will work. That means if a person does not have the scripture, if a person does not have the word of God, that person's prayer will not work, because there is no faith without the word. Because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. You can come for 100 retreats. You can see thousands and thousands of healings and miracles. But only the day when you take the word of God, and when you keep hearing and hearing day and night, that is the time faith comes. Your next question will be, then I no need to do any other work? I'll give an example to make you understand this hearing and hearing. There is a person who goes to the doctor. And doctor says that you have so and so sickness and you will not live more than 6 months. How many times did the doctor said those words to him?
Once.
But after he leaves that hospital, how many times that word speaks to him? Anybody can speak to him, but that will not go in. But the word which the doctor said will be running in. When nobody is there, tears are falling. Why? That word is talking to him. That means he did not only hear that word from his ears, physical ears, but also his inner ear, he kept hearing what he heard once. Yesterday, my brother was preaching on the woman who had the issue of blood for 12 long years. And it says that somebody came and preached the gospel to her and she heard about Jesus. What she heard, the message, the word of God that she heard it only once. But what she did, what she heard, she kept on meditating and kept on thinking and kept on pondering. But she had a choice. She can also think, because the Bible says that she spent everything she had, but she grew worse. She was isolated from her community because she was unclean. She lost her money, she lost her health, she lost her reputation, she lost everything. Now she can ponder on those words the doctor said, she can ponder on the words the society said, because on those days if a woman has an issue of blood, then she is unclean. She can ponder on those words that are spoken by others. Or what the doctor said, or what is happening, her financial condition. She lost all her money. She has nothing now. But she chose to keep meditating and keep speaking the word of God. When we hear a negative word, when somebody abuses me, somebody hurts me with their words, what will happen to me? I take that word and I keep on thinking. Yes? That's how faith also works. That word has to speak to me. The Israel people saw so many miracles, so many wonders, so many signs. But when God wants to speak to them, what did they say? We don't want to talk to him. Moses, you talk to him and you tell us what is the message. Because they did not want the word. Without the word of God, nobody can have a relationship with the Lord. The Israel people saw miracles, they saw wonders, they saw signs, but they did not have the word. That's why the gospel preached to them did not profit them. Give Hebrews 4 verse 2. For unto us the gospel preached as well as unto them. Who's that them? The Israel people. The gospel was preached to them. What was the gospel? They were all slaves in Egypt. But God gave them the promised land. That was the gospel. But even though God gave them the land, the promised land filled with milk and honey, as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them. In spite of seeing so much of miracles, in spite of seeing so much of anointing, so much of God's signs and wonders, that gospel which was preached to them did not profit to them. Today, the gospel is preached to each and every one of you. But is this gospel going to profit you? This gospel will only profit you. See, as well unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. Without faith, you can't receive anything from the kingdom of God. Without faith, you can't receive anything from the kingdom of God. It's again a law, it's again a principle that I have to understand. And this faith can come by only hearing, and hearing by the word of God. How was Abraham able to believe that kind of promise? Because Abraham was in the presence of God. Only because he was, the Israel people, they saw the signs and wonders and miracles, but they were never in the presence of God. That's why they couldn't mix their faith to what God has promised them. But did Abraham see such kind of miracles? Did he see the Red Sea departing? No. Even though he did not see any kind of signs, he did not see any kind of miracles like the Israel people, he believed when God said, I have made you the father of not children or one child, and I have made you the father of nations. He believed. And how he believed? In the presence of God, he believed. Yesterday we saw one scripture. I want to go back. I want to revise that. Go to Hebrews 11, chapter verse 3. Through faith we understand. See, without faith, our prayers will not work. Without faith, we cannot receive anything from God. And without faith, we cannot understand. How was Abraham able to believe? Because with his carnal mind, nobody can understand. Can anybody understand how I can become the father of many nations? Nobody can understand. But a person who's operating in faith can understand. Yes? Because yesterday I said we have two kind of senses. One is the physical sense and one is the spiritual sense. Okay, I will read the scripture and then explain to you. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen, that means they are physical things. They are things that can be seen, or in another way, the things which have physical evidence. Okay? For me to understand physical things, God has given me physical senses. With my eyes I can see. Yes? With my ears I can hear. I can touch, I can smell, I can taste. These senses are given to me to understand things that are in the physical world. But only through faith we understand what the things that cannot be sensed or seen or heard with the physical senses. Are you understanding? Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. So that the things which I see is not made of things that are seen. That means things which I see is made out of things that I cannot see. The things which I see is the physical thing, and the things I cannot see is the spiritual thing. And the only way that I can understand things that I cannot see is through faith. Praise the Lord. So I have to develop this faith sense. Faith is an ability. My eyes, the problem is I try to see, I want to see Jesus with my physical eyes. But God did not give you eyes to see. Can anybody see with the ears? No, the ear is given to hear. The eye is given to see. I cannot misuse it. Yes? I cannot say that I use my mouth to see. No. The purpose of the eyes is to see. In the same way, how the physical sense are given to understand physical things, in the same way, faith is also a sense. It is given to understand unseen things. But the problem with us is we are trying to use our five senses, our physical sense, to understand spiritual sense, and our five sense does not have the capacity or the ability to understand unseen things. That's where you fail. That's why Abraham did not fail. Are you getting? The Israel people, they failed. They did not mix their faith. The reason they did not mix their faith is they tried to understand God through their senses. But our senses does not have the ability or the capacity to know or understand God. Your five senses, your physical senses are not given to you to understand unseen things. Only through faith we understand things that cannot be seen. That's why Abraham believed. How he believed? In the presence of God he believed. That means what? He spent time in the Word. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. When he was spending time in the Word of God, that Word gave him the faith. When I say word, it is not just word. Go to John 1:1. In the beginning was the, see it is capital W. In the beginning was the, that means what? In the beginning was God. In the beginning was the Word. That means nobody can know God or be in the presence of God without the Word. If you don't have the Word and you say you know God, you are a liar. If you don't have the Word and you say that God spoke to me, it is not God who spoke to you. Because in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. I cannot separate God and His Word. God is Word Himself. And the Word is a spirit. My brother took the word is spirit and life. You remember before the break? That word is John 6:63. It is the spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profits nothing. The word that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. The Word of God is God Himself, and the Word of God has life, and the Word of God is spirit. That means it's not a physical thing. Words are not, God's Word is not a physical thing. It cannot be seen with your eyes. Words are spiritual things. It is a thing. The word of God is a spirit. And the word of God has life. When you spend time with the word of God, that means you are spending time with God himself. If you are pondering and if you are meditating the word of God, that means you are in the presence of God. Did God ask Abraham to sacrifice his only son? Was he ready to sacrifice? Okay, let's go. Let's go to Genesis chapter 22 from verse 2. And God said, and he said, take now thy son, thy only son Isaac, whom thou love, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of. Next verse. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son and clave the wood for the burnt offering and rose up and went into the place of which God had told him. Then on the third day Abraham lifted up his eye and saw the place far off. Then and Abraham said unto his young man, abide you here with the ass, I and the lad, we will go yonder and worship. Put RSV, fifth verse. Okay. Then Abraham said to his young man, stay here with the donkey, the boy and I will go there and we will worship, and then I will come back to you. I will come back to you. Oh, you are alert, huh? I will come back to you. I will come back to you. Is he going to sacrifice his son? Then how can he say the statement? How did he get that faith? How faith will come? What promise? The son has come, no, already. Huh? Why not? God can't give another son? What? How faith comes? How faith come? Okay, so how he got the faith that they will come back? What he believed? See, you can't just believe anything. Faith doesn't come. See, faith is a principle, faith is a law. It will not work without the promise. Why, if he gave Isaac, he can't give next year another son? He did not say that. I don't want the answer from here, and they are giving me the answers. I know when to ask you all question. You want the answer? See, if a person is operating in faith, that means that person has an evidence. Without evidence, a person can never operate in faith. I want you to understand, faith is a law, faith is a principle. Faith will not work without the promise. If Abraham is saying that we will come back, that means he has faith and he's sure, he has 100% confidence. He has that assurance. Without the assurance, he cannot boldly say that we will come back. Take Hebrews 11:1. See, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for. Give me the other translation. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. When I say faith, that means with my five senses, I cannot see, but with my faith sense, I have evidence to see what is in the unseen. That means Abraham is believing because he has an evidence with him. You know, suppose if there is a crime taken place, okay, and the judge has not seen the criminal, but they got the fingerprints. Will the judge say, even though there is a fingerprint, I will not believe until I see? Or he will say, even though I have not seen, the evidence is so clear that he is the criminal? In the same way, when I say faith, I with my five senses, I cannot see, but because I have the promise of God, I have the evidence of God. Without the evidence, suppose if you don't have the promise of God, if you are in a situation, in a circumstance, if you are not so sure that God has promised me this, you cannot operate in faith. And your prayers will be, if God wills, let it happen. Did Abraham said like that? If God wills, let it happen. Or he said, we will come back. He said, he will come back. He did not say, let it happen. Because he knew what is God's will. How did he knew what is God's will? Because what God promised is what is God's will. In the same way, you're not supposed to say, let it happen if it is God's will. You should know what is God's will. And we all know what is God's will when we know the word of God. We don't have faith because we don't have the word of God. We think, we pray, I have faith, I have faith. What do you say? What do you mean you have faith? If you say you have faith, that means you have the ability to believe something that you cannot sense with your five senses. I'll repeat again. If you say that you have faith, that means you are believing something that you cannot understand or perceive with your human senses. That is called faith. Faith is not going and crying about your problems. I believe Lord will do one day. That is not faith. When I say faith, that means I have a more sure, assured word of God promise with me. When I say I have faith, that means with my eyes I cannot see. I don't have any physical evidence, but I have the promise of God. That is called faith. And Jesus said, your faith has healed you. He never said your prayers have healed you. Your prayers will not work if there is no faith. Are you understanding? And what is that promise he had? Go to Genesis 20:21-12. And God said unto Abraham, Let it not be grievous in thine sight because of the lad and because of thy bondwoman. In all that Sarah has said unto thee, hearken unto her, for in Isaac shall thy seed be called. Can you give me the other translation? For it is through Isaac that offspring shall be named for you. That means God has promised him that through Isaac will be your descendant. He said very clearly, through Isaac. Come back to Genesis 22 verse 4. 4. See, on the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place far off. On the third day. When God promised him, after God spoke to him, after 3 days, Abraham looked up. After 3 days. What was he doing on those 3 days? He was in the presence of God. He was in the presence of God. It is impossible for you to understand what God has spoken through your senses. Only when you take the promise of God and ponder on it, meditate on it, speak it, hear it, now you are in the presence of God. Only a person who is in the presence of God, that means a person who is spending time with the Word of God, now that person receives the ability to understand things that cannot be seen. How do we live our life? What is ruling our life? What is governing my life? What is dictating me? What I see? Yes? What I go through? What is happening? That means I'm not operating in the faith sense. I'm only operating in my 5 senses. In the presence of God, Abraham believed. Whatever God has promised, you can never believe it with your senses. The Bible says that you can do all things through Christ who strengthens. Can you believe it? With your senses, you can't believe. The Bible says that when you lay hand on the sick shall be healed. Can you believe it? The Bible says if you speak to this mountain, the mountain will be uprooted. Can you believe it? That's why God said Mark 11, have faith in God. And then he says, speak to this mountain. Why he's saying, without faith, you can't believe what the scripture says. And our prayers are not working because we have not understood about faith. We have not understood the power that is in the words which we speak. But Abraham was able to believe because he was in the presence of God. We have to develop. Okay, we will learn on that, how to develop. Come back to Romans chapter 4. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of God in whom he believed. If you see, the same Abraham was once upon a time who Abraham. Yeah? Did Abraham believe? No. Did Abraham believe? Yes. Why? Because Abraham was only seeing the physical. But Abraham is seeing how? Because Abraham was using his senses. But Abraham is using his faith sense. Go to Genesis chapter 15 verse 1. I'll show you. And these things, the word of Lord came to Abraham. Ask your neighbor, are you Abraham or Abraham? Okay. And after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision. Which came in a vision? The word of God. God did not give Abraham a vision. He gave his word through a vision. Are you understanding? See, without the word of God, you can never have a relationship with God. You can go to so many preachers, so many people, and they can pray and they can say, I saw in a vision that there is a curse in your house. I saw in a vision that says something dark in your house. But as long as that person is not giving you the promise of God, that person does not have the God you have. That means it's not from heaven. That message is coming from the hell. You don't need to believe it. Because the vision is not important. That word that came to Abraham is important. If somebody is seeing a dream or somebody is seeing a vision, that is not important. Because that vision is only a mode which God used, because on those days, they did not have the Bible like you and I have. So God had to use the vision and God had to use the dreams to give the word. It is the word. God gave the word to Abraham. You know why? Do not be afraid, Abraham. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. Then read next verse. Read.
But Abraham said,
O Lord God,
what will you give me?
Is a prayer like this?
Yes.
O Lord God, what will you give me? Is your prayer like Abraham or Abraham? O Lord, what will you give me? I am a poor man. What I know, I am nothing. I am a zero. I am childless. I am a diabetic. I am very old. I can't see properly. I can't walk properly. See, Abraham also like him, like us only. What is he saying? Oh Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless. And the
heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abraham said, you have given me no offspring.
Stop. You have given me
no offspring.
Lord, you have not given me this house. You have not given me this job. You have not given me. Or like this we'll say, you only gave me this husband. What to do? Oh, you only gave me this wife. What can I do? Do we pray like that? Is Abraham praying? Yes. But what is he praying? What is he saying? He is saying what he has. As long as Abraham is going to say what he has, nothing what God has for him will fulfill in his life. But the same Abraham, when he became Abraham, when God is saying, go and offer your only son, what he's saying? We will go and we will come back. He's not saying what he's saying. See, what a drastic change. You know what changed him? The presence of God changed him. The presence of God changed him. What will change you and me? The presence of God. And how can I get into the presence of God? Only through the promise of God. Only through the word of God. He was speaking from his senses. For him, all he knew is, I'm old. I'm childless. What you have given me? And the most smart, you know, when you are operating in the in your senses, you become very smart like Abraham. He became very smart. You know what he said? Don't worry, Lord. You want me to become the father? No? Don't worry. Through my servants, my servant's son is there. I'll make him my. I'll adopt him. Shortcut. Do we give shortcuts to the Lord? Do we give plans to him, Lord? You do like this, you do like this, you do like this, then this will happen. Because God is not smart enough, no? So I have to give him ideas so that he can easily fulfill what he has promised. Do we give him shortcuts? Do we give him ideas? Why? Because we are seeing the problem from our senses. Abraham also was seeing his problem from his senses. What he saw? He saw that he's old. Logically, I'm old. Have I ever seen such old man and such old woman having child? And this God is saying, I have made you. Now what to do? Okay. I will adopt a son and I will fulfill what God has spoken. Continue. But the word of the Lord, yeah, read.
But the word of the Lord came to him, this man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said.
He brought him outside. That means he's telling Abraham, stop looking at your things that can be seen with your physical eyes. Come out from your physical to the spiritual. He's telling, come on, Abraham, you are only seeing what is in the physical. You come out from the physical. I will teach you how to see the things that are not seen. I will teach you how you can develop your faith. I will teach you how I have given you the ability and the capacity to see things beyond your physical. Come out. Stop focusing on your weakness. Stop focusing on your physical things. Stop focusing on what you're going through. I'm going to teach you something. I'm going to teach you about things that cannot be seen with the physical eyes. I'm going to teach you how you can activate your faith sense. come out. He brought him outside and said, look toward heaven and count the stars. Why is he asking to count the stars? So if somebody has no children, you will say the Bible says when Abraham did not have children, he said count star. So you will counsel them, go and count star every day? Imagination of what? Okay. Did we learn yesterday that God is a God of hope? Yes. Does the Bible says that your hope has healed you? What does the Bible say? Your faith has healed you. What is faith? Now let me see. What is faith? Next time if you give me this answer, no? That answer should come only when I ask how faith comes. When I ask you what is faith, that is a different answer. Then? Good. Anybody else? You were not there yesterday, so don't worry. She also stands sitting like you only. How faith comes. When I ask you, if you, the teacher, no, in the paper, when the question is asked, when you write some other answer which is right, the teacher will yet put wrong. You should answer only for that question. You're a teacher? All my life the teachers bashed me. Now I am asking the teacher's question. What is faith? You told me how faith comes. What is faith? Definition of faith. I think first I have to make you learn the definition and then come and say the definition. Then only I have to continue the session. Anybody else? I know who came yesterday. See this student copying and saying the answer. Okay, at least say, sister. I think I should not change the topic. I should continue on the same again and again and again and again and again. What is faith? What is faith? Faith is smiling like this. Faith comes by hearing again and again, but what is faith? You were not there yesterday. I have given them the definition. I'm expecting the answer. You can drink the water and give me the answer. You know the answer, I know. Trust is different, faith is different. Both are not same. I didn't ask from you. Okay. Say, fully say. That container is an example. Okay. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Now who answered? Now you got up? See, this is the definition. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. That means what? Faith provides the substance for what I am hoping. You want me to repeat it again, what I taught yesterday? Okay, I'll repeat. Faith is always now. Faith provides substance. Okay. Before I say about substance, now faith is the substance of things hope for. What is hope? This also I asked yesterday. Okay, good. You're having the notes in your hand? Yeah. At least he's saying and giving me some answer. No, at least. Desire, imagination, future. Hope is a... Anybody having any kind of pain here? Any sickness? Full body. Full body pain? So God will heal?
Yeah.
Didn't I ask her yesterday the same question? Okay. Now, does she has faith? What she has? She is saying, will God, the moment I asked, will God heal you? What she said? Yes. When she said yes, that means, is she operating in faith or she is operating in hope? She is operating in hope. The moment she is saying God will heal me, it is in the future tense. That means she is expecting something to happen. But faith is now. Now faith. Are you understanding? Praise the Lord. That's what we saw in Hebrews 11. Third verse, that the things that I cannot see, the things which I see is made out of things that cannot be seen. That means there are things that I can see with my eyes and there are things that cannot be seen with my eyes. Whatever is in the promise of God, the written word of God, are things which cannot be seen. And how did the things that cannot be seen came into the physical? By speaking words. Words are containers which contains substance. Are you understanding? So when I speak the word of God, that word releases the substance. When I say hope, hope is an imagination. Hope is an expectation. I hope I will buy a house. I hope I will get a job. I hope that this will happen. The moment I say hope, that is it in the future tense. But did God operate in hope or faith? Did God say, I will make you the father of many nations? Or he said, I have made you the father of many nations? Are you understanding? As long as, sister, do you believe that Jesus will heal you? Again, she's saying, yeah. That means, as long as she's operating in hope, will faith provide the substance? No. When I say hope, hope is an imagination. For example, I told this, but I'm repeating again. When you're building a house, will you have a blueprint? Yes. Is it in the imagination? Yes. But will that blueprint become into reality without the raw material, without the substance? No. If you are going to buy a house, first you go, if you are going to build a house, first you make a plan. And you have in your imagination, the house should be like this, the hall should be like this, the parking should be like this. You make an imagination. Without imagining first and doing the blueprint, will you build a building? No. In the same way, without hope, will faith work? No. What is Abraham imagining? Abraham is imagining. What is he imagining? He is imagining that I am childless. When his hope is I am childless, will faith work? No. Are you getting it? Now for her, her hope is right. What she is hoping? That she will be healed. Yes. But for that hope to become reality, faith has to come. But for Abraham, the hope itself is wrong. What is he believing? That he is childless. Are you understanding? That's why if you see, many of them are hopeless. Many of them have wrong hope. Many of them have hope. Without hope, faith will not work. As long as he is thinking that he is childless, he cannot have children. So God has to change his hope. God has to change his imagination. So why did God ask him to count the stars? Because he has to change his imagination from childless to countless children. Are you understanding? That means what I cannot imagine will never happen in reality. If you can't see yourself healed inside, you can never become healed. If you can't see yourself prosperous, you can never receive prosperity. If you can't see yourself successful, you can never be successful. You know, I always say, Redima and Yolanda, when they come with me, I always tell them the secret of healing the sick. I always tell them, if you want to see signs and wonders, what the Bible says, when the believer lay hand on the sick shall be healed. When you speak to the mountain has to be uprooted. If you have to see that kind of things happening in your life, do you want to know? Yeah? I always tell them, you have to imagine. What you have to imagine is, you have to see when you are laying hand, the eyes are opening. You have to see when you put your hand, the lumps are disappearing. You have to see when you are speaking, the dead is raised. You have to see when you speak, the hand is growing. Where? In your imagination. Can you come and share what happened, how the devil deceived you that you can't do, and how that song helped you to imagine?
Hallelujah. Praise God. Okay. Don't feel bad, brother. So I used to go with Brother Linton, Sister Shaila, and Yolanda. We used to be four of us. And you know how Brother Linton speaks, right? With full authority. So even when I used to sit behind, I used to say one word also, it'd be so loud, I'd keep my mouth shut. I couldn't speak. Nothing bad after that. So then the devil started putting thoughts in my mind. You cannot preach. You cannot do this. You have no power. And I started thinking, yeah, I cannot preach. I cannot talk. I have no power. God has not sent me to preach at all. And there came a time where everything was going good, up, 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 up. And suddenly it became a down. There was one praise and worship I was leading completely in my senses. It was like a performance. And from like this, I became like this. And slowly, slowly, this started happening. And Satan is putting, sorry, preaching is not your cup of tea. No, no, no. And slowly, you know, whenever I used to sit to hear preaching also, no, Sister Jocelyn, I used to feel irritated. I cannot sit. I couldn't hear. And this is after I'm like growing in the word very nicely when I knew all the definition. At least you all don't know. I knew the definition. Faith, joy, love, law, everything. And still I'm sitting there all irritated. I can't hear a single word. As though my ears are closed. She's talking but I can't hear a word. Satan is like, sorry, it's not yours. Preaching. It's never yours, never yours. And I started imagining, yeah, I'll never be a preacher. I'm not a preacher. It's not my calling. I can't speak a single word. What am I going to preach? All these words started coming, and then literally a point came in my life where I said, I will never go to lead praise and worship. I will never go to preach. So even if when she used to come and tell, go lead praise and worship, I'd say, Yolanda, you go. I'll not go. I don't want to lead. I can't say. I can't play. I can't do anything. Literally, I was like, I will never go on the pulpit. The Satan put such thoughts, and I was going literally mad, like mad. Then we were in Mangalore all together. I, Yolanda, Sister Shail, and they were observing also. Sister Jocelyn said, what is wrong? And I would say, nothing, you know, tal dete, kya bolega? Because Satan was bashing me up so bad. And then we sat, and she was preaching this. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to the gospel. And I was like, Lord, you have promised me to preach. And she said, let's all sit and we'll keep on, you know, saying the scripture again and again. And while you're saying, you have to imagine that you are preaching the gospel to the poor. And we were saying, the Spirit of the Lord is up. First, it was all action from my side. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because God has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Like that only, just for the sake of saying it. Suddenly she tapped me and she's like, imagine that the Spirit of the Lord is in you and you are going to preach the gospel. And then slowly I started imagining, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because my God Himself has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. And we kept saying, and I kept imagining, saying, imagining. My audio and my video matched. And I was screaming that night. I was screaming. Things like, I was shook when she took this scripture. Because I know what was going through. I already, just like how Abraham imagined himself childless, I imagine myself, I'll never be a worship leader. I will never be a preacher. Never. It's not me. I can never speak. And just like how God had to change Abraham's imagination from childless to father of many nations, my God had to change my imagination from no preacher to that He has sent me, He has anointed me to be a preacher. God had to change what is going on in me. And all this didn't happen all of a sudden. Slowly Satan put me in it, slowly. And I never realized when I was totally into it. As soon as my imagination was changed, that whole night I kept saying that scripture. Next morning I kept saying that scripture and we went for a house visit. And I'm sitting there. And everyone are like talking, you know, talking this in the word of God only. And I wanted to say one line, you know. I said one line and Yolanda cut me off again. And I'm thinking to myself, preaching is not for me. Once again. Next day, this is exactly the next day. And I'm like, preaching is not for me. Preaching. That's the voice of the devil saying, preaching is not for you. Preaching is not. You can't say two words. What are you going to preach? What you're going to counsel? And as soon as this started coming, no, I'd already gone to the washroom and I'd come and I sat down. Abhi wapas kaisa washroom jane ka? This happened second time with me. And I was like, I can't take it. The same frustration that I had, I couldn't hear a single word being preached, that same frustration was coming in. I said, before it comes in, I have to fight back and change my imagination. And no, sister has taught, you can't fight a thought with a thought. you have to fight thoughts with words, and especially the word of God. I ran to the bathroom because I was frustrated, you know. And I looked in the mirror, I'm like, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Again, I had to talk back. I had to again change my imagination. Because the Satan will again put in words and again he'll try to make you hopeless. But you have to fill it with more and more faith by opening your mouth. I went, I'm like, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. My God himself has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. And I started dancing in the bathroom. Because in that time she was teaching joy at the same time. I was in the bathroom like, Spirit of the Lord is upon me. My God himself has anointed me. Literally, I was dancing in the bathroom. He has sent me. He has sent me. Yes, he has anointed me. To preach, to preach, to preach, to preach. And I became like my whole, with the moment my imagination, the moment I kept saying the imagination, the thought vanished. My imagination changed to I can preach. Yes, I'm sent to preach. I'm sent to preach. I came out and I sat. And the moment we sat, Sister Lavina, she was going through the same thing I was going through. I found my client. God sent my client to me. The moment I changed my imagination from I cannot preach to I am sent to preach. I sat there, I gave her my own testimony of what I was going through. Even she couldn't bear listening to the word of God. Even she's like, I cannot speak to anybody. I can't go to house to preach to anybody. Same thing what she was going through, just like me. And I found my client. And when I gave the same thing. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. My God himself has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Same thing. And the moment she also kept saying, her imagination changed. Hallelujah. Just like God changed Abraham's vision, imagination from childless to father of many nations, I also had to change my imagination from not being able to preach to he has sent me. You know, even I used to think that preaching is a gift. It's not for everybody. You know, leading praise and worship is just a gift. It's not for everybody. But the word of God says, go and preach the gospel. It is a commandment. Go out from this place, preach the gospel. It is not a choice. It is not a choice. If I want, you can do it. No. It's a commandment. Go out, preach the gospel. The same thing I had to keep saying to myself. I am going out. I had to keep saying because my words create imagination. When I kept saying, I'm a preacher, I'm sent to preach, my words changed my imagination. And when my imagination changed, my actions changed. Now I can speak so confidently. Because this confidence is not of my own. This confidence is coming from this word of God, which says that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And he has anointed me to preach. I am sent to preach. The Satan will put words and put imagination in the negative side. That's why we have the word of God, our weapon. That we have to open our mouth, use our weapon, and change our imagination. Our fight is not with the devil. Our fight with the thoughts, the negative thoughts that he keeps putting in our mind. You know, if God wouldn't have put me with people like them, I would definitely gone into, you know, depression, and I would be out by now. You would have not seen me here standing. Literally, I would be dead in the world. Definitely, because I was mad. I became mad. I became aggressive. I couldn't take it. So I used to go to places just for the sake of being there. That's it. And then, you know, when these thoughts again and again were coming, and I was fighting with it, and I was like, Lord, if I cannot speak, no, then what am I going to do? And the Lord said, hold on, you are going there to learn. You're not going there to do time pass. Because what I used to do, you know, when they used to counsel, I used to be with my phone. Really, I used to be something doing here, looking here, there, not paying attention to what was being preached, what was being told to the other people. The Lord said, I'm not sending you there to sit on your phone. I'm sending you there, learn, listen to what they are preaching. Pick up, take the scriptures, note it down, write it down. And the moment I started going with them, and I'm like, Joshua 1:8, 1 Peter 2:24, Luke 4:18. When, as soon as they would say scriptures and give the explanation of that scripture, I would sit. First I sit on WhatsApp. Now when I go, I open my notes and I sit and type what is being taught. And after that, there was a time when I had to go alone out of my own house to preach to the other people. Now I am backed up. Hallelujah. The same thing, if it have gone before, no, I would have imagined, no preacher, no nothing. I cannot speak. I cannot do anything. I'm not sent. But when I got to know this scripture and when I changed my mind, now when I go out of the house, I know that the Lord has anointed me to preach. The same way, this promise is not just for me. This promise is not just for me. This promise is for each and every one of us. The Spirit of the Lord is not just upon me, Brother Linton, Sister Jocelyn, and Sister Shaila. No! The same Spirit what we have is the same Spirit what you have. No change. Some people would come, Sister, you dance so well. Sister, you sing so well. It's not that. As Jesus is, so are we in this world. We are like God. Our one third of our being is God, because we are joined with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is in me, not sitting in heaven. Where's the Holy Spirit? In us. That's why the Lord says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon you. He has anointed you, appointed you. Change this. Change this. If you don't fight back, he will kill you just the way he was going to kill me. I am now armed with the word of God. I've put on my armor of the word of God. Trust me, if this armor wouldn't have been there, I would have been dead by now. I really, when I sit and imagine myself in that time, I was like, Lord, if you wouldn't have been there, if you wouldn't have said that day, it was not Sister Jocelyn who was speaking. That day it was the Lord speaking to me. No, Ridhima, you're not weak. I have sent you. Go out, preach. It is for that I've called you. It is for that I've created you. Go. And I started going, and the day I changed my imagination to God's word, God's imagination, God's will in my life, when I change my desire to his desires, my life has changed. And the result is here, out. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's why I keep saying these notes. No, we used to tell Sister Jocelyn, you're torturing us. You know why? After this program, no, we used to go home. No, she would sit and ask question, what is faith? And if we don't give answer, then we are gone. Again, she'll ask, what is hope? After 10 minutes, what is faith? The torture. You'll understand, literally call you torturing us. But the moment we learn these definitions and the meaning of these definitions, we see the difference in our life. That's why we tell you all to write notes. Now it's a torture for you all. Exactly. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, when we are telling you to write notes, this, if you don't understand faith, no, you don't understand anything. This law of faith and law of this, that, if you don't understand what is faith, what are you going to apply faith? Every promise stands on faith. You want to receive anything, it is only by faith. Hallelujah. 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 So, sister, will God heal you? Yes. God has. How can I say that she is healed? She is saying God has healed. So, I say I am Amitabh Bachchan. Ho gaya? How can I say that she is healed? Joy on the face. No. How can I say that she is healed? How can she say she is healed? Yeah. Which verse is that? 1 Peter 2:24. It is not just because I am saying you are healed. No. It is the word of God that says that she is healed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Satan will tell you, you are not healed. You are not healed. Until and unless you don't know the promise of God, what are you going to stand on faith? Where's your faith? That's why we get deceived. No. For you all, at least you all didn't know. I thought even knew the scripture that time. When the Satan was putting me into torture. But I never used. You can have all the scriptures you want. But if you don't use them, if you don't say them, nothing will happen. It is like you're going to the battle and you have a sword which is nicely on the altar covered with plastic. You understood what I said? Huh? No, the sword is covered in plastic. No, the Bible is covered with plastic, no? Some people even put gift wrapper. What is your sword? What is your sword? Word of God. Where is it? On the altar. Isn't it? Yes or no? It was before. Good. Good. Praise God. Now it's time to get your sword out. It's time for war. It's not, everything won't be goody-goody in God's kingdom. We think we are in the Lord, everything will be good. Everything is good because we have the word, we have the promise, we have the love. But we have to fight because it is a fight. It is a good fight of what is this good fight of faith? The fight is to believe on the things unseen. There is a battle in the mind where Satan is telling you, see, you've got pain. But on the other side, the word of God says you are healed. It is a battle. Hallelujah. And this battle can be won only by faith, by the word of God. Hallelujah. 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 So, are you all going to wrap nicely the sword and keep it on the altar? No? Or take the sword, keep it in the pocket. Come, Satan, I am here. Let's have a war. Hallelujah. 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 So, it's tea time now. See, you all want to see a difference? Yes or no? Next month we are coming. You have 2 weeks time. 2 weeks is a long time. Use the same thing. Apply it in your own life. See the difference in your own life. And then you can do it to others. In my life, you know what happened? First, I got all this. I tried on others. It worked. Later, I tried it on myself and it worked too. The moment it worked on me, I got the confidence like, yes, it's not fake. I told her, I used to think all this, no? What you all do, healing and all, was fake. Really. Even after being with her, I used to lay hand and all, I used to still feel it's fake. You know why? We used to lay hands, no? How are you feeling? How much is the pain? They'll say 60%. Then again we would say, then they would say 70%. Then again we would, because for us, we need 100% healing. Our God doesn't do half. He does full. Everything sau takka. 100%. So then after 80%, even we would still pray after 90%. So I used to think that they are frustrated with our prayers. That's why they are saying they're healed. Really. So for me, I used to literally feel that it's all fake, it's all joke. But the moment when I fell in the pit, no, and I had no option but to use my sword, even I had kept it nicely wrapped on the altar. But the moment I used that sword and I fought the battle, I got my victory. Am I different from y'all? No, we are all the same. We are all the same. I have fell number of times. I told her, in the beginning when I used to lay my hands, no, people used to actually get healed. Okay? Then there was a time when I used to lay my hand and people used to not get healed. First person, no problem. Second client, not happening. But when she is laying the hand, they are getting healed. Meaning first it was a game of luck, haath lagaya, heal ho gaya. Now the reality is coming out that I cannot, lay my hand, blah and blah and blah. And even you all thought the same, what? Have you all tried? Try it. And I was like, then again the thought came, no, it's all fake. The moment I started thoda believing also, no, that also was killed. Thoughts, imagination changed. From I can lay my hand and the sick shall recover, to I can lay my hand, the sick shall not recover, but when Sister Jocelyn lays her hand, the sick shall recover. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Then I went to the Lord, Lord, what is this? Why are they not getting healed when I am laying my hands? The Lord said, the problem is you are trying to heal them by your hands. You understood what I meant? I was trying to heal them. I was trying to heal them. It was like, I am laying my hand on you, that's why you're getting healed. I am laying my hand on you, that's why. First the confidence was on God, but then the confidence came on me. I am doing it. It's me. It's my power. Hallelujah. My imagination changed from God laying hand on the sick through my hands. It changed from I'm laying my hand on this sister and she's getting healed. See how slowly the Satan will change your imagination. That's why they were not getting healed. Because I was imagining that I'm healing them. No, it's just my hand. The power is still with God. Hallelujah. I am not the healer. Sister Jocelyn is not the healer. God is the healer. I only lay my hand, open my mouth and speak. I change my imagination, their imagination, and the job is done. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So now you see Abraham's imagination, my imagination. We're both on the same boat. Now the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for my God Himself has anointed me. Acha, what is... I thought you're asking me. Now, what is your imagination? Sure. Yeah, after some time. Yeah, I'm weak. I'm sick. Sister, pain. Now, we will stand. No, come. All those who are sick, come stand in line. Everyone will come. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It is a battle between the seen and the unseen. What are you going to imagine? Where do you see yourself? You know, Satan's strongest weapon is deception. He'll deceive you. He deceived me. That's why I was going that side. But when the Lord changed my imagination, when He showed me the truth set me free, and now I am free. The devil is still telling lies. Tell him the truth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can we stand? Make a small prayer. Let's all close eyes.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, that you have revealed your truth to me. You changed my imagination, Lord. In the same way, Lord, you are changing our imagination to what you want. You are changing our imagination like the Word of God. Lord, the Satan has been deceiving us throughout our life. But Lord, it's time to remind him of the truth. Lord, now no longer am I going to keep my sword on the altar, but I'm going to take the sword and I'm going to fight the good fight of faith, Lord. And I will win this fight of faith, Lord. I'm ready to change my imagination to your word, Lord. Lord, let your word abide in me. Lord, Holy Spirit, you inspire me. Give me people, give me opportunities where I can speak, where I can preach. Because, Lord, your word says that I am sent to preach. We are all sent to preach, Lord. Give us the confidence, not confidence in our own self or in our own works, but, Lord, our confidence is on you. You are the God. And you will always be God. Can we say the scripture together? The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. My God Himself has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Once again, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Okay, now let's all close eyes. The same thing what I did is now what you are going to do. We'll all close our eyes and we'll imagine. Now it's time for you to imagine. See yourself, see your own face where the Spirit is in you and you are preaching the gospel to everyone. Hallelujah. Let's all close our eyes, imagine, open our mouths and say. When your audio and your video matches, definitely there will be result. All together, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is the same way we fight. This is the same way I fought. I got my victory. Now you fight 2 weeks. And when we come back, definitely I want testimonies. Because my God always confirms His word with signs and wonders. If you use His word, surely the signs and wonders shall follow you. Amen? Amen? Amen. We shall have tea and we shall be back soon.